situations or our questions inside or our difficult relationships, and that this love can be shared in the family. And the main topic what inspired us was listen first and try to understand. And it fits together also with the illness. If illness can introduce itself to us, then we can understand. And then nothing can stop us to heal this, to listen to the children. And how we can learn to listen to each other, that we can understand, or we can even stand on the side of somebody and go together to some other specialist or somebody who can help us. And also Mr. Hamdan, Ambassador of Eritrea, thank you for coming and being here with us.
Thank you.
And also other people from Guinea, you are first time here, I think.
It would be less of training directly on the actual curriculum that requires 3-day intensive workshop, but probably the main principles of what we're talking about are important for you to capture so that you know where things move forward. Some of you know who we are, some of you don't. So I'll go briefly on this. So we are the UNODC, we are an office of the Secretariat specializing on drugs and crime affairs, and basically we're headquarters in Vienna, but we have several field offices. And our main mandate focus around the areas of drugs, crime, and terrorism. We have lots of field offices in different countries. Meaning, despite our presence here, we are more present in the field than in Vienna. We were established in 1997, merging two different bodies, you know, a body that dealt with the crime issue and another body that dealt with the drug issue. And each one of these two bodies had a different governing structure. So we're not a UN agency that supervises what countries are doing. We're the other way around. Member states have a representation, a commission that deals with drugs, and another commission that deals with crime, that meet and set their priorities in the sense of what, on behalf of the General Assembly, what priorities are need to be taken in terms of resolution for drugs and resolutions for crime, and the UNODC tries to assist these countries, these member states, with these resolutions through three main pillars. We have technical collaboration projects where we build the technical capacity to do the work on the ground. We do research and analytical work to understand what the situation is, you know, in the different domains, regardless whether it's drugs or crime or terrorism. And then we also have normative work. So we work with the countries in order to change and ratify the implementation of certain laws, legislations in line with what they need to do. So we work on several areas, not only drugs, but regardless where we work, organized crime, trafficking, human trafficking, or drugs trafficking, everything, corruption, crime prevention, drug abuse prevention, and terrorism prevention. But I'm part of the division of operation that deals with the health response to drugs, prevention, treatment, and rehabilitation section specifically. So our work is guided by the conventions that go there. But important to note that the same bodies that I'm talking about, whether it's the Commission on Narcotic Drugs or the General Assembly of the United Nations, which are all the member states of the United Nations, have agreed on a path forward from 2009 to 2019 to tackle the drug situation. This political declaration is that political declaration that expires in March 2019. But it kind of puts a balanced approach between tackling the drug problem, not only from the supply perspective, but also from a demand reduction perspective. And when we say demand reduction, we're talking about programs that are related to prevention and treatment of substance use disorders. So it's not only like cutting the drugs and stopping the drugs is going to solve the problem, because, you know, we have an example in the United States where the main problem that exists now is an opioid crisis, which are prescription opioids in the majority. And it's not a matter of cutting or not cutting, it's just like drawing a line of in terms of, from prevention, a health perspective of the drug situation. It's not illicit versus illicit. It's a matter of any substance that are under national control has to be maintained within a system where its use for medical purposes and scientific purposes is accessible and granted for everyone that needs it, but it's non-medical use and non-medical purposes, and if it doesn't have medical value, it should be out of system. So this is where we have the countries in terms of dealing with that problem from different perspectives. It's important to note that all member states of the United Nations are part of the political declaration. Another important scenario that needs to be in the background when we're talking about this is the Sustainable Development Goals. So in 2015, there has been the Sustainable Development Goal, a path for 15 years to 2030, in terms of what are main areas of work that countries should invest in order to reach sustainable development in general. So you see like these 17 domains of work, and you see I'm going to just highlight one specific one of them, which is domain number 3 on good health and well-being. By itself, being an investment for sustainable development of any country. But it's important to note that one of the specific targets of that goal is to strengthen prevention and treatment of substance abuse, including narcotic drug use. So we're not only talking from a human rights perspective of availing prevention and treatment services. There is enough science to request that, you know, all member states of the United Nations have agreed that such services are important for the sustainable growth and development, not only of the country, but the world. And I'll talk gradually why this is important. And by the way, that statement, the General Assembly also has met and also reiterated the fact in terms of this political will to move forward with the Sustainable Development Goals, as well as the political declaration to move forward in the General Assembly. And it's under the title of our joint commitment. So there's a commitment from member states to move in this direction. So what do we do in the field of prevention with this introduction? The traditional approach of prevention is always, when we talk about drug prevention, the point of focus is drugs. So most member states go and address the problem from perspective, what is my drug of problem, and how to deal with it is usually to is made under the perspective that people are making a wrong decision due to a lack of knowledge. So I need to tell them what the problem, what the drug is, what the drugs are, what are the consequences are, and just like raise the awareness. And usually it's linked to scare tactics, you know, sometimes exaggerated beyond the limits. But the core principle upon these upon which these responses are built is that it's a personal choice and I want you to say no. That's why most of the campaigns are under the say no initiative. But the main core principle that we're trying to change in regards to the etiology of the problem is it's not as simple as that. It's not a switch that you can turn on and off that easy. The issue is much more complicated than this when it comes to addressing the response. So it's not only a lack of information that is leading, especially early initiation of substance use. We talk about children and adolescents to engage in substance use. It's not the lack of information that is the missing link, but there are other factors that are much more in depth. If you think about it, self-esteem, awareness, raising awareness of, so having, you know, the peer pressure, pro-social attitude, exposure to drugs, warm, close relationship with the parents, satisfaction with prevention program. So there, you start, like, when you start digging about it, there are so many different issues that we can tackle and to address that problem that goes beyond this. And this is where we proposed that when we want to say prevention, what do we mean? And what should the drug prevention response be based on? And from the cumulative knowledge that exists in the field of the science of prevention, what works and does not work in the field of prevention, so that you can have as policymakers or as advocates or as, you know, NGOs that want to advocate for, or whatever it is, what works and what does not work in the field of prevention. So the prevention standards is that tool. It doesn't show you how to do prevention, but it tells you, like, you know, when you think about prevention, what should you think about in which social institution and what works and what does not work under which principle. So this tool is available online, and you can, it's self-free, but I'll just give you an overview of it as we speak. So the first element that we try to engage with these member states is tell them that, you know, prevention is not a field of creativity. It's not whatever you want to do, you can do intervention. I mean, good intentions are good. However, it's important to note that with all good intention, there are prevention initiatives that can be done. In all good intentions, however, the consequences of this is not lack of effectiveness. That's not the worst case scenario. The worst case scenario is that there are prevention initiatives that actually can increase the risk in substance use and in other people's emotions, not only his own emotion or her own emotions, what are other people feeling. So basically these are things that the child are not innate to them. I mean, the child needs to be taught in terms of understanding them. And this is how, because like, if he doesn't understand how other people are feeling, the way they're reacting to it might cause a negative reaction and might gradually start causing social isolation and removal. And problem solving, and not necessarily like solving a crisis, but you know, problem solving in the sense of like preparing the child at this age to go to school. So things to understand, you know, like, you know, what is, you know, this is small, this is big, this is large, this is heavy, this is, you know, I am heavier than the other person. My child, for example, and I'm teaching him this right now. I mean, my daughter is 9 months old and he's 3. So for him, jumping on my daughter is something very normal, and he's playing around, but he doesn't understand that he's heavier than her. And so these are things that are he need to be taught for him when he sees like everybody reacting, pulling him away and like shoving him away without explaining to the child that why we're reacting like this, puts him in an emotional stress. He doesn't understand what is happening. So basically the parents love that child more than the other. So these are things that the child needs to understand and are not innate. So these are things that there are programs to help parents, you know, deal with these things. Middle childhood, we said the child wants to school, programs to maintain attention, control emotion, social inclusivity, you know, how to be part. I mean, building relationship is, as I said, it's a skill. Effective communication, receptivity to others, accurate perception of emotions is also very important at this age. So prevention programs that needs to be assisting the child are orbiting around these things. Adolescent is like something, because like this is where most of the programs are proposed, are expected things, you know? Social emotional skills, sensitivity of feelings, conflict resolution, pro-social skills, and impulse control. These are the main things. Conflict resolution, of course, in the sense of somebody telling you like a piece of information and you challenging that piece of information, whether or not you're challenging it the right way or not. But you know, these are things that a child needs to learn in terms of like how, where to seek information in terms of what is right, what is wrong, and not to immediately challenge without really understanding the context of it. So with that being said, so this is when we go and we talk to policymakers. It's an eye-opener for them to really understand. First of all, the first session was like, you know, are you doing prevention from the day, when we're talking about prevention of drug use? You're talking about, we're doing prevention when the child is born? You know, you can do prevention, because like most of the prevention programs are offered when the child are only already adolescents. So yeah, I mean, yes, every developmental stage has its own goal marks, and like initiation of substance and like prevention of substance use can occur, prevention of drug use can occur from the time when the child is still in the womb of the pregnant mother, not necessarily when the child is an adolescent. Yes. And then each phase has different protective and risk factors that need to be strengthened, and then you have to look at phases of transitions, and not, you know, a cross-sectional, so this is where I'm going to intervene because they use drugs. Because if you intervene with programs when they're adolescent, it might be in several cases a bit too late to do this. So, we have personal characteristics that need to be addressed, mental health rate, neurological development, stress reactivity. These are things that are under our skin, you know, every single individual have them differently, that are influenced by the by macro and micro level influences. Like the family, the school, the peers, or the micro level in terms of like the family, if they're living in a poor situation or they're living in a situation where there's armed conflict or there's access of weapon or war, there's crime, there's the physical environment around it. So all of these interact with each other at different ages of development, and if not addressed, will cause not only substance use, and that's the main thing in terms of addressing it from a holistic approach like this. These same problems are not only associated with substance use, but academic failure, poor social competencies, poor self-regulation, mental health, physical health, all of it are within the same structure of things. So you can imagine a child who's grown to have aggressive behavior, sensation-seeking behavior, has language delays, poor decision-making, solving, living in a family that has negative role modeling, neglect of and then harsh, abusive, neglectful parenting, in a school where there is poor quality of education, and he has antisocial peers, and living in a country of armed conflict, and you're doing a prevention program of just saying no to drugs. And these are the contextual circumstances where our kids are living, and this is where a formula that doesn't really kind of help when it comes to prevention. And this is the change that we're trying to do. So it's not only a matter of switching. There's multiple settings, there are multiple ages that you can address. The same risk factor is linked to more than one outcome. These are just examples, I'm not going to go through them. But this is where the link with violence, which is the most important thing, and this is the most recent. This is a relatively, it's in 2012 publication in terms of the World Health Organization talk about preventing youth violence. What is the evidence? So they talk about seven strategies to prevent youth violence in general. And one of them is parenting and family skills. But the most recently, there's another sort of new publication that came out. This is INSPIRE, which is a joint publication by, I'm reading for you because they're too small for them, WHO, UNICEF, UNODC, USAID, PEPFAR, PAHO, the Pan-American Health Organization, the World Bank, different CDC came together in terms of a strategy to prevent violence against children. And this is a program that talks about the different strategies, and I'm going to tell you in terms of what we're doing in terms of a health response to address that strategy as well. So, substance use prevention is supporting the development of children from growth from different age, and addressing many risk behaviors and health conditions, and not just discussing drugs. The first version of the standards was in 2013. The second version was in 2018. I'm going to skip just to tell you in terms of what is the content of the standards. This is the 2018 version. So basically, it summarizes for the policymakers that there are problems in the families, in the school, in the community, in the workplace, in the health sector. And then these you can do from prenatal up to adulthood. I'll give you an example of one of them and just let you get the rest. And then you see also colors. There are things that you can do. Green is universal. Any child, regardless of the level of risk, can be exposed to them and will benefit from them. There are programs that are in yellow, which are selective programs. Selective programs are for subgroups that are at higher risk than your average people. So for example, people living in rural areas, or people living in conflict zones, or people that have living in violent communities, or dissociated communities. And there are programs in that are indicated. So you're no longer dealing with a group of people, you're dealing with individuals that already are showing symptoms of a risk behavior, and you want to address that risk behavior now, before it escalates to something bigger. So prenatal, so basically when it comes to intervention for pregnant women, any pregnant woman that is actually either using drugs, alcohol, tobacco, can expose the child genetically to predisposition in terms of withdrawal symptoms, including, in terms of at birth. But also, it could be an opportunity as well to present mental health support to the mother as well, especially postpartum. There could be programs that could teach parenting skill on a selective level. These are all in yellow. Parenting skills for mothers that are giving challenging situations already can help mothers, bring up, have the skills that are supportive to the child, especially in the first 3 years of life, which are very sensitive. And then in the school, you have programs at early education school at the selective level, preparing kids to go to school, and then within the school level, at early ages, you can have classroom management programs. For example, I will talk about the school and the family at a later stage. But there are sets of programs that are there. The standards does not present how to do the program, but tells you the from the science what are the qualities of the program that made it successful and qualities of the program that made it not successful. So basically, when you go back to your country, you can check what sort of prevention, so you can use that matrix to see what do I have in terms of programs at different age groups that the, I mean that my country offers as programs. By the way, there are lots of things that are put there that the country does not program as part of the drug prevention strategy. So you can use that same program for drug prevention purposes. For example, intervention for pregnancy, there might be like the Ministry of Social Affairs or the Ministry of Health might have programs for outreach for women in special circumstances that are pregnant, but they never consider this from a drug prevention angle. So you might use that program in your matrix. You can also, and then you can check after you see all of these programs, what exists, you see like what is missing. So you can propose to add it. And then you can look from what exists, what are the characteristics of the program that exists nationally, and compare it to what is in the standards when it comes to make it effective to see how we can improve it. So that's in a nutshell how the prevention standards program can of parenting skills to reestablish the bond so that the child doesn't have that increased risk. In Honduras, high level of violence, they're using the family skills program from a violence, youth gang violence perspective. Dominican Republic, in favelas, in orphanages, a caregiver doesn't have to be the mother and the father. The caregiver might be a different person, and this is where you can help establish these communications. So there's diversity of uses. Any child at any age, regardless of who the caregiver is, can benefit from such programs. The results, this is from Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and these are the things that we're trying to change. Family cohesion, family conflict, family relationship, family child bonding, all of them have moved in the appropriate direction. Regardless of the country, I can bore you with the statistics, but you know, I can keep you the statistics and you can see. We're looking at not necessarily substance use, we're looking if the programs are actually changing the parenting functioning. And regardless of the country where we were, actually the programs are being more effective than in their country of origin. Because of the fact that in the country of origin there are lots of social institutions that are providing already some level of services. Which means when you're running a clinical trial and you're testing these programs, the control group that you're having is not a control group that is not receiving, because always when you do a clinical trial, you have a control group, a comparison group, and a group that takes your intervention. In the countries of development, the control group is receiving something. It's not like not receiving anything. So basically, when you're doing your trial, you're not noticing how effective your program is as compared to people that have not taken anything. In the countries where we're working, the comparison group is really as a group that is taking nothing. So you see a big accentuation and differences between the intervention and the control. We are encouraging the all of these, anybody who's interested in any of these publications, I can provide them to you on an individual basis because they have copyright for your personal reading. But you know, we're encouraging publications. So basically, in Central America, Central Asia, we published you know how the work on families and schools together has changed the functioning of families. We'll have another publication in terms of how violence have changed in Central America and Caribbean, South America, Southeast Asia, Southeast Europe, and in Central Asia. The families, the same family skills program, but on violence. In Panama, we have lots of studies, and currently we are doing a clinical trial of how the family skills program, we're testing it in Panama City in 28 townships around Panama City that have the highest homicide rates in the country. And we're trying to see how these programs are preventing, even though the program was introduced as a program for drug prevention, how it's changing the level of violence and criminality. Because, you know, this is the power of a family as a social institution when you really try to help it. So, we published also a nice chapter in Cambridge Handbook International Prevention Science. Also, we can provide you with that, talking about how this initiative is working. So, what are we doing right now? We are, instead of using evidence-based programs and adapting it to the local context, we are developing our own programs that are open source programs. that you know have no copyright fees and no royalty fees, and are designed for the countries that we're serving as United Nations. Because the other programs are designed in the US and the UK, so they assume that an infrastructure exists that in the countries where we're working does not. So it's a bit costly. It's not very costly. We chose the most economical ones, but still for some countries to bring them to scale is very economically challenging. So we're developing our own. We prioritize two programs. One program that is selective, and these are for families that are living in challenge settings. We're talking about the refugees, we're talking about displaced, we're talking about those in conflict or post-conflict situations. These are programs that are important where the parental role are a bit stressful in a different way. It's not only the challenge of having an adolescent, it's having an adolescent in a conflict zone. So these are programs that are selected. And then we have another program that we're designing. The first program has already been designed and is currently piloted in Afghanistan, in Serbia, on refugees in Serbia, in Zanzibar, in Dominican Republics, in favelas. So we're testing it as we speak. The program is called Strong Families. And we added to it other sort of supportive programs. I'll talk about them. But we also, as we're doing this, we're developing a universal family skills program for any family that have, you know, adolescent kids. However, the program is designed for low-income countries. And this is a program that we should be ready by the end of December. And the first piloting site will be Bangladesh and Indonesia. So because of the donor, Japan prioritized these countries, and we're interested to work there because we have not worked there before. So this is Strong Families, and Strong Families has been part of a set of programs that we're presenting. I'll talk about them in a bit, not too much detail, but pilot in conflict zone, we need to disseminate information. You don't necessarily can get them like in a room like this and like, you know, let's discuss parenting skills. It's especially the refugees. You need to disseminate information. And we try to do this first by using the Red Wrapper study with the University of Manchester. They took the lead on this. It's a one leaflet that contained essential parenting skills that was distributed through bread bags. These are the kind of bread that is distributed, in my part of the world, really, in bags. I don't know if you can see them clearly, but there's a bag, and inside it there's a leaflet with parenting skills. So people receiving the bread bag are taking the bread, but they're also getting that leaflet in terms of like, what are essential, in terms of like, how to recognize stress in yourself, how to recognize stress in your child, how to deal with that stressful situation in your child, you know, the bed wetting, that's happening on an adolescent, which is not normal, how to deal with it, how to recognize, you know, these are, you know, just a one page, which is double-sided. Parents were extremely excited about it, and in terms of like learning something, in terms of, because they are, you have to imagine, this was distributed in Syrian refugees camps in Turkey. A refugee is not a migrant. A refugee is a person that, you know, yesterday was a normal functioning family, you know, nothing, and then suddenly the next day, it's living in a circumstance that was not predicted and expected. And so the parents are not prepared to see and to deal with specific situations. So they need that sort of help. Beyond just food and shelter, they need help in terms of how to deal with that specific situation. And these are like very low, basic sort of non-training modality sort of things that are useful for them. We raised the bar a bit more when we told them, like, listen, on top of this leaflet, we prepared a booklet and a two-hour seminar. So you come in, a two-hour parenting seminar, only for parents, when you talk about the same thing that is in this leaflet, but in a bit more detail. And then there's a booklet in terms of more detail to receive. We have piloted this in Palestine, in Nablus, in the West Bank. We have a clinical trial of a group of families that took this program versus a waiting list. It's being published as we speak, and we can share this information for you. But these are also one of the tools that, you know, you can think of. They're available currently in three languages: Arabic, English, and I think in Farsi, the Afghan Dari language. And then this is strong families, which is more interactive. So there, you're talking about the program where you train people on a training manual, so that they go and engage these trainers with families and provide them specific sessions on specific skills they need. So they train on these sessions, and there are the parents, the children, and the family comes together. It's a structured program. So it's a different level of implementation. And this is the program that I mentioned is done in Afghanistan, in Zanzibar, and in Dominican Republic. And then on the top of the pyramid, we had the TRT Plus, which is a program that addresses trauma in parents and children, as well as dealing with parenting skills. And this is the most recent thing that we're doing, the open source program, that the meeting was on July 10th. And then this is the program that will be implemented in Bangladesh and Indonesia. And we're doing the same thing in schools. So I just want to show like some slides to just to highlight what it is. So this is a program that prepares kids on a selective basis, kids that are in low socioeconomic status in these sort of families, prepare these kids to go to school. So these are preschool children. They're not in school yet. But it's a program that helps them, you know, on these problem-solving skills and just prepare them to be at a certain level to access schools. And then they compare the kids that took the program, the blue line, to the intervention group. The people that took the program are the blue line, and the people that did not are on the red line, and they just followed these kids until they were 21. So that's a program that is not discussing drugs at all, but it's just helping preparing kids to go to school and that go to school. And they compare them, those that took the program, at the level of using marijuana during the last month at the age of 21. And you see like it was reduced by more than half. Just preparing these kids, and these are randomly distributed between those two programs. But that same program carried an effect in terms of the possibility of becoming a teenage parent. So, it was much less likely to be a teenage parent if you took the program versus you did not. And the possibility of being enrolled in university. So, it was twice as likely. So, you can see that, you know, an exemplification of the concept of, like, you know, you're addressing a vulnerability at an early stage with focusing on the individual, you're not discussing the drug, and you see its effect on more than one level. Personal and social skills are important when it comes to school. They improve a lot of things with regards, I mean, they are structured programs. It's not like, you know, when we talk about personal life skills, we're not talking about just doing a random session here and there. It's a structured program that around the several skills, and they're interactive sessions. So the teacher is there, but the teacher is not doing the session. The kids are discussing a specific topic and how to deal with it. I give you an example of social life skills situation. So let's say we have 20, 25 kids here, and I'm the teacher, and they discuss, you know, one of the kids came and offered you a cigarette to smoke. And you want to say no, or how would you deal with that situation? So they start brainstorming and discussing in terms of like strategies, you know, thinking about it. I'm in that scenario, how to deal with it, you know? So, and then, you know, one of the scenarios that, you know, the teacher in terms of, as a facilitator needs to focus on is not only saying no, but also saying no while trying to help that other child not to use the drug, the cigarette as well. So they think about the strategy in terms of resistance. So for example, you can come up with an alternative scenario. Why don't we go to watch a movie or like go bowling together or something like this? So you're still having that relationship with that child. You are helping the other child not to use, you are not using it yourself, but you're also helping the other child not to use it as well. So you start putting the kids in a proactive stage of, you know, not only resisting social pressure, but being actively engaged in terms of preventing that behavior in other kids as well. So this is not a simple program, just like, just say no. This is a program in terms of like, they start thinking about a strategy. Yes, they start, and like, there will be a peer knowledge in the sense of like, this is what should happen in that perspective, within that social environment. So it's a different context in terms of how to apply these programs. child development also, like, you know, we can talk about another example in terms of, you know, this is at an earlier age in terms of life and social skills, why we're talking about they're important. But just to give you an example, how to be your best in school, sort of learning how to put up a quiet hand, handle it. So basically, in terms of the child doesn't know how, you know, the value, the importance of in respecting rules, including in class. So they start teaching them, you know, in terms of like techniques, in terms of like how to be the best at your school, learning how to keep a quiet hand, how to handle other children who poke you, how to learn how to stop, think, and check, for example. That's one of the exercises, you know, because kids at the, you know, in age 5 to 7, you know, react to things, but they just don't think before doing a reaction, and they just say the things as they are, without thinking in terms of how the other kids might feel and react to what they're saying. Anger management techniques at that age are very important, because to deal with frustration. So these are programs that are designed for that specific age group. And I hope I have, yeah. So this is the one of the examples that are there in terms of like the turtle example. How to, like, you know, when you're faced with something, when you feel angry or something, to stop, get inside your shell, think about it, stop, and then come out and do something. Just the fact of, like, give it 5 seconds before you react, to calm down, try it again. So these are things, skills that are being developed in terms of anger management as a short example at a specific age that are important. Classroom environment improvement as well. Talk about one example, just go practically. This is a classroom management program. Doesn't discuss drugs at all, but helps the teacher in terms of, like, rather than just come in and present the group of 25 kids, you know, a lecture on biology, and then the kids are distributed the way they want. You know, usually the most attentive are in the front. We're not in a classroom, but, you know, the less attentive are in the back, or, you know. But so the teacher comes in and, like, knows these kids and, like, redistribute them in terms of themes. So, for example, we have Team 1 to Team 5, each one has 5 students, and the teacher purposely mixes these kids, the most attentive to the least attentive, the most hyperactive, the least hyperactive, you know, these teams. And each team has to respect the rule. And each team is either rewarded or removed from a privilege based on the reaction of each one member of these teams. So basically, each team is responsible to support each other in order for them to be a good team. So the classroom is managed in a different way, in order for the kids feeling responsible and have a role in the sense of maintaining the management of the class. And that also puts the kids in a way of socialization which is different than the others. And these programs, these programs have been effectively showing, like, you know, just changing the way the classroom is managed in terms of reducing possibility of drug dependency in the future, smoking challenges, violent and criminal behavior, because these are programs that are usually mostly applied in terms of more aggressive classrooms than others. So there are lots of studies, like, showing, and you see them in the details of this are in the Listen First campaign, the way they work. So I think these are the essential things that I wanted to discuss with you, but I wanted to leave you with, we have all the statistics that showcase that those take the life skills education programs versus that don't are at a much lower rate of using substances than others. The main conclusions are, message number one, there is no need to improvise in the field of prevention. And I gave you an example in the beginning of, like, the danger of improvisation. One example that comes to mind is, you know, using recovered drug users that are also common when it comes to prevention. And these are one of the programs that carry what we refer to as iatrogenic effect, which is a program that is designed for prevention, that's put in as a prevention technique, but unintentionally actually increases the risk in certain high-risk groups. You know, I'm a recovered drug user talking about, you know, how I was abused when I was a child, you know, and I went through all of these situations, and I have 100 people in front of me, kids, you know, that are going there, and how I escaped from that situation, you know, using drugs, and I went through the streets, you know, and eventually, and I came back. So what is happening here is like you have these 100 people in front of you, you have like maybe 90, 98 of them, you know, increase your resistance skills in terms of resilience, of not using drugs, but you have these two kids that are going through the same situation that that person have went through, in terms of abuse, neglect, and it's, and never consider that the drugs could be an escape scenario. And even this, whatever that person is describing, you know, going through the drug hell that he's going through is probably easier than the hell that person is living through the situation that's there. And indirectly, so that program, it is that exposure that triggered actually possibility of substance use among these highly vulnerable kids. And the intentions of the prevention program in reality was, you know, really to help these two, not the others, because the probability of others using drugs is much lesser. And this is where we have lots of evidence in terms of these programs. I'm not saying like recovered drug users don't have a role in the health response. They're really good when it comes to drug treatment and engaging with drug users and encourage them to go to treatment, but not for prevention among adolescents. And these are things, you know, where the prevention science help policymakers decide not only what is effective, what is harmful, you know, so which is even more dangerous. So there's no need to improvise. There are many effective strategies. So that's another thing. It's not like, you know, you don't have to start from scratch because they exist. And we have less like 50, 60 years of science that's showing you that these things happen. And there are lots of things that in different age and different settings, they are, these things don't focus on the drug. They focus on preventing not only drug use, but many other social behavior. And that's the value and importance of this. The earlier you react, the better. Not all programs need to be done only in adolescence. You can start at a much earlier stage to avoid not only substance use, but many other things. At the same time, it's never too late. You can always, you know, there's indicated programs, even when the behavior starts happening, can prevent it from escalating to something bigger. And we have to use our limited resources there. So I think, not to dwell too much on time, I'll give room for
questions.
Thank you very much. Talks about parenting skills. Inspire ending violence against children. Talks about, you know, several strategies. Caregivers and family support is there. Us, UNODC, working about drug prevention. Family skills is at the core of the response. Our justice section talks about, you know, juvenile justice in terms of ending, violence. Now they're integrating families in terms of their handbook. So basically, at this stage, I think it's becoming like a core component in terms of the world, because at the end of the day, it remains one of the most powerful social institutions. I think it's much more powerful than the school or any other educational system if it's really kind of integrated.
So congratulations to your work. This is absolutely badly needed.
I'm fortunate to have been granted that project to coordinate. I mean, this is one of my favorite projects so far. This is my sixth project that within the UNOVC. I hope that will never end.
Some questions? Protected and valued. And in order to do so, we have to understand why it is so important, how it is so important. And statistics are so important in passing that on. So, advocacy. For me, I'm trying to think not only about sharing some of this in our broad chapters, maybe some nations that could even help you somehow and use this program, but in terms of advocacy on family. And also some of the, when you were giving some of the results of this, even over the short period that you've been working, you can see that the results are not only strengthening family, is not only helping to reduce drug abuse, but actually so many in this survey, there were so many different things that are affected so positively by this. And I'm hoping that you, your agency, your department will publish and promote all these
coming out of it and really checking them, you know, as you're assessing the success of the different programs, so that that can also be shared and in an interagency fashion, also as you mentioned, because we really see a not so much talk about family, and when it is, it tends to be the problems of the family and not the positive parts. Huh? Mm-hmm. So we would really, even maybe some of your books, or I know you sent me many links, and I've looked through quite a bit of that. And can we have your, it's fine with you if we're promoting some of these points in our statements at the Human Rights Council and kind of referring to...
For us, anything, I mean, for us, that everything that you mentioned is like things that we're aiming to disseminate.
Okay.
We have no problem with this. This is the main message, and we're going with having. But when it comes to specific publications, I can share them with you. They're not owned by us anymore, you saw them, because we publish in peer-reviewed journals.
Yeah.
So you can use them within your internal circles, but we cannot, for example, put them on a website for mass dissemination. And that's what we can do, because they're owned, copyrighted by the journals. So if there is a mailing list, I'm more than happy to share with you all the publications. We have about 7 or 8 now published in really good, you know, peer-reviewed journals in the field of connection science that I'm happy to share with all of you. And you can use them within your own close circles in terms of, like, you know, from the impact of our work in the field. That I can share, but I mean, they cannot be made public. That's the main condition. I don't know if there is a mailing list, I'm being happy to share them with you. And then we can send them to everyone else.
And I think especially to our UN office teams too.
So, last question.
That's my tweet. There's something called UN speed, which is much slower than the speed of light. An update. And if you have any, provide you with information. Because, as I said, I mean, what you're doing in the field is much more important than we're doing. We're working with policymakers changing their point of view, but you're at the front line of making it happen. So we need to collaborate, that's for sure.
Thank you very much for coming.